Joining us on Hot Copy this morning, we have Health Secretary Francisco Duque. Secretary Duque, good morning to you, sir.
Good morning to you, Karen, and to all your viewers and followers. Thank you for the opportunity.
All right. Now, Secretary, following the eruption of Mount Bulusan, what is the Department of Health doing on the ground?
Oh, well, a lot. You know, I have been meeting with my director, Ernie Vera of Region 5, Bicol. And I have instructed that all the prepositioned supplies must already be distributed to the affected families and especially those in the evacuation centers. No? And I've also already instructed the distribution of N95 masks and N88 surgical masks to protect our people from the ashfall and its impact on eyes. Kaya may advisory tayo on eye care, on respiratory care, as well as the proper handling and preparation of food, and of course, boiling of water. So we have already cascaded all the advisories to the affected communities through the Region 5 DOH in coordination with the local government units. No? So nagpadala tayo, halimbawa yung pangalaga sa well, we have already set the hygiene kits, the potable water jerry cans or containers, and these have been already distributed, ongoing pa rin the distributions sa Tuban, no? But anyway, just to emphasize that napaka-importante that our people are protected from the impact of the ashfall. Well, that's why yung magsuot ng safety goggles, and the face mask is an important reminder. Huwag mo lang gumamit ng contact lenses kung naka-contact lens, no? Kasi mamaya kakamutin yung mata dahil initan na itong fluorine and ashfall elements, no? Yung consultation natin ng mga pasyente, no, na pagka may mga symptoms. So all these advisories, I don't have to put them or enumerate them one by one. We can just send you all these advisories.
All right, Secretary.
Lungs.
Okay, Secretary, you mentioned goggles. I'm curious, did you mean the Department of Health is also distributing goggles to residents, or that's for the healthcare workers?
That's for the healthcare workers, and also what is important is for them to be given their face mask N95 and N88.
Is the Department of Health covering anything for the residents? Or LGU po yun?
Yeah, no, it is a whole government approach here. No? So the national government complements whatever LGU lacks. We fill in the gaps. So that has been what is being done. So tuloy-tuloy at pagbibigay natin ang mga supplies and personal protective equipment or PPEs.
But, now, this is not the first volcano eruption under your term. What should residents watch out for with a phreatic eruption? What's the effect on their health? Short term, medium term, long term?
Well, your immediate term, no, is to really avoid going out of their residences, no, and they should make sure that their windows are covered with wet blankets or anything that would effectively filter out the ashfall and its toxic components or elements. No? So carbon dioxide is one, fluorine is another one, no? Which can irritate the eyes, the lungs, and other parts of the body, the skin, no? For example. So we're taking care of that eventuality. But it is best to prevent, and so we advise our residents there to avoid going out as much as possible, no? And to make sure that they apply, you know, pagpasang mga blankets or para lang magkaroon ng filtration against these toxic substances, and then the wearing of face masks, no? Both N95 and N88 are very important. And our local health care frontliners, together with the DOH, they are monitoring the health situation there. Dahil alam mo na ba, pagdating sa mga evacuation centers, yung Hawaan, malakas ang possibility niya, ano? Kasi halos tabi-tabi na naman ng mga tao dyan. So, we continuously remind them of the health protocols that we have already put in place ever since naman, like, you know, Taal volcanic eruption, nagkaroon lang tayo last year, 2020, and also last year, and then ngayon, ganoon din, no? So pretty much our people are already sanay na, no, to respond this calamity.
I'm curious, will the president be visiting? Will you be joining him, if ever?
Yeah, maybe. That's why we're going there. Immediately after this, I'm flying to Davao City and get our presidential directive. If he decides to go there, we all will go there. Mm-mm. Immediately, okay. If the president's judgment calls for it.
All right, let's move now to another topic. Some good news for the Philippines. The Philippines ranked number 33 among 121 countries in terms of COVID-19 recovery. That's based on the Nikkei 19 Recovery Index. What do you attribute the Philippines' increase in ranking for?
A lot of things, no? Number one, in terms of our people's discipline compliance with the minimum public health standards. You know, Karen, the John Hopkins University survey from September to April this year, no, 91% to 96% ang masking rate or compliance ng Pilipinas. Yeah. And that's really very good because it really synergizes or complements our vaccination to curb the transmission. And that's why it is small wonder that our transmission rate is very low. In fact, our case load metric shows yung average daily attack rate plus, of course, our growth rate as minimal to low risk, no? Low to very low risk. No? And then our healthcare utilization rate is also very low. And so, you know, Karen, this is a marathon. Yung mga iba kala sprint, eh, no? Pabilisan, you know, ganun. But we steadily, you know, orchestrated the national government's pandemic response in collaboration with the national, with the local government units, and also important, equally important to call it, private sector, no? So, ito ang mga dahilan, good compliance with minimum public health standards in general, and masking in particular, a good vaccine rollout. We have a 77% coverage of the target population of 90 million Filipinos. We completed inoculation, and then of course our loosening up a great deal of our social mobility restrictions. In fact, majority of our regions, if not all, with some still already in alert level one. In fact, the alert leveling system, I think, is a best practice, no, that the Philippines can showcase, no, because maganda, no, alert level one. Wala na tayong widespread community lockdowns, no. Those days are over and done with. So these are the three things that I believe have contributed to our massive progress in our COVID-19 recovery index. No? So we've bested 80 other countries, no? Richer countries, resource-rich countries, no? UK, US, Switzerland, Israel, Japan, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, even Singapore, you know, number 79 lang sila, no? So noona, okay, medyo nahumula na tayo, no? Pero ang laban dito, marathon nga ito, hindi ito yung pa-impress ka lang na, okay, ito, politically correct to do. No, we were outputting all our decisions on data-driven, evidence-based science and medicine, no? And I thank all our panels of experts, no? Dahil ang ganda ng kanilang inputs to all the policy. 200 policy issuances, Karen, ha? And this served as the basis for the effective implementation of our prevention, detection, isolation, treatment, reintegration, vaccination, plus booster strategy. So these are essentially the reasons why there's been a massive progress in the way the government has led the nation, of course, through a whole of government, whole of society, and whole of system approach.
Okay, now given what you just said, you talked about public compliance. Does this mean that masks are here to stay in the Philippines?
Until the end of the term of President Duterte, yes.
Mm-mm. Tapos sa susunod na pangulo, bagong terms na yon.
Oh, yes, oh. But we will still convince them to continue on and build on the gains of this administration.
Okay. Another question is, well, first, the government also had problems in securing vaccines. Do you attribute the availability of the vaccines to having dramatically improved the country's rankings?
Of course, since October, when nag-stabilized na yung supply natin, we were receiving almost 1 million doses a day since October, and that certainly substantively contributed to our relatively high vaccination coverage. Although, of course, I'll be the first to admit, we still have to do a lot of ramping up with our booster dose.
Yeah.
But absent a law, it's only we are convincing, educating, counseling our people to get their booster doses.
What can we do? What can you do before you leave office, Secretary Duque, to actually improve the number of booster shots, right? So far, you only have 14.3 million Filipinos up to date with their booster shot.
Yeah, that is correct. As I've said, it's quite anemic. We've done everything that we could, and we continue to innovate. So we started off with Res Bakuna sa Butika, you know that, no? And then Res Bakuna sa mga klinika with the Philippine Medical Association to improve access, no? And then Res Bakuna in the public transport, in the airports, seaports, and in the land transport terminal exchanges together with UTR, we have brought an improved access, no? To the booster doses, and also in public areas, no? In fact, to the extent that we have also brought vaccines for booster sa mga call centers, no? And then sa mga schools, sa mga simbahan. So, name it, even in the prison, you know, sa mga piitan, ay lahat po ay pinalalawin natin ang kakayanan ng ating mga kababayan na maabot nila ito. And I would like to take this opportunity, Karen, no? That this is the best time to have their booster shots. It's when manuwag ang vaccination centers, not when there's a surge. I tell you, if there's going to be a surge, mahihirapan na naman. Doon lang mag-sisiksikan muli ang mga tao, mainit, mahaba ang pila, samantalang ngayon manuwag. So ngayon na po natin samantalahin ang manuwag na bakunahan. At huwag po natin huwagdasin ang pagkakataon ito, libre ang bakuna, epektibo, de kalidad, ligtas. Katawan nyo na lang po, dadalhin ninyo. Sana siguro naman, hindi nyo na makakalimutan iyon.
Now, Secretary, some experts have suggested that the definition of a complete vaccination shot instead of two shots be redefined as three. Do you believe that this would help increase the number of booster shots if there's a redefinition of complete shots?
Yes, I will be the first person to tell you I agree with that. But the IATF, alam mo naman, it's not just made up of, you know, the DOH, but there are also others constituting the economic team that frowns upon or does not agree at this point. Of course, they want the boosters ramped up, but it cannot be via a de facto parang mandatory booster na no booster, no transport, no booster, no ride, no booster, no full capacity in the establishment. So we're still grappling with this, no? But hopefully we are getting more and more evidence, no? And other countries, around six na lang, although kukunti pa lang, no? Who have redefined the meaning of full vaccination to include one booster dose. So siguro we will reintroduce this in the IATF for a consensus and more widespread support.
Oh, so that's the booster shot. That would be the third, which some people feel because it's called the booster, parang optional. But then there's also the fourth shot, right? This is the second booster. Right now, it's given to immunocompromised seniors and all health workers. Considering we have ample supply, Secretary, would there be a chance that it be made open to all who want the shot?
Yes, theoretically, we would welcome that. But as I said earlier, we are evidence-based. Okay.
Yeah.
So we need to get the inputs of our health experts, our vaccine experts, no? Our PAG, lahat sila, we have 11 panels or groups of experts, no? who continue to guide us in terms of policy adjustments. No? So one area is really yung booster. And supply-wise, wala nang tayong problema. We have enough supplies. In fact, COVAX is willing to replace all our expired and near expiry vaccines. No? So that's one major issue that has been addressed. But also, we are requesting COVAX to replace even those procured by the local government, the national government, and the private sector. So yes, you are right. This booster dose is really important, but we have not gone past A1, A2, and A3. No?
Yeah.
So healthcare workers, we're giving now the second booster dose. The senior citizens, yes. And of course, persons who are immunocompromised or persons with comorbidities, provided their doctors certify that they need the second booster shot because of other concomitant illness or disease.
Because Secretary, sayang naman, do you have the numbers? Kung ilan ang expiring vaccines?
But yes, I think we have, and so far as the expired vaccines, it's less than 2%. Because, you know, the expired vaccines over the total vaccines we see, which is about 244 million. So it's less than 2%. So, and this is progressive. No? So each day, it's eating up on the shelf life or on the expiration date. And that is why we sat down with COVAX, and COVAX said, okay, we will replace. We have asked them so far about 34, 36 million vaccines to be replaced.
Yeah, no, because I mean, you are leaving in less than a month, I would have to say, right? And you have other countries who've already made the decision that they can have a fourth shot, right? I think Israel, tama ba ko, Secretary, there are countries where in the fourth booster shot is relatively open to all adults. And then you now have Sweden, who will be starting a fifth shot already for anyone 65 years old and above. So you have countries already making these decisions fast. Bakit sa atin, Secretary, ang bagal? Eh, kumbaga, tapos na nga ang administrasyon.
You have to understand, Karen, ha, that these vaccinations have been under an emergency use authorization. Ha? Wala pang clinical trial phase 4 that would merit a certificate of product registration. So that's a safety issue pa rin dito that we have to be careful about. You remember Divac siya, no? So mahirap naman. We will let others, if they want to go ahead, let them. We learn from them. Okay? If we think and we are confident that the safety issues have been monitored and addressed, then I am confident that our vaccine expert panel, our technical advisory group of experts, will be the first ones to recommend. Kasi mahirap tayo magpag-alus-alus dito, Karen. You know, we're talking about these vaccines are relatively new. No? We don't have very long experience. And like, we're not talking about measles vaccines here.
Yeah. But then, Secretary, yun nga rin ang tanong ng ilan. Don't you think that Pfizer, for example, should no longer be under EUA because the United States FDA has already approved Pfizer as the first COVID vaccine? It already has FDA approval in the United States. Kumbaga, we're talking about that's the leader already approving Pfizer. Why are we still on EUA with Pfizer?
Well, as I've said, no, the vaccine expert panel is on board here. They're the ones who look at the data. They're the ones who review the summary of evidence. Inisa-isa yan. Uh-huh. And to me, I think that is prudent. However, ang problema hindi naman yung second booster shot or yung third booster shot. Ang problema yung first booster shot. Yung first booster shot natin, ang tama.
Yung pangatlo.
Why do you even worry about the second or third?
Eh, yung first na problema pa natin. And that is why with the media like you, Karen, I hope that you will sustain your campaign for the first booster dose. And that to me is what we need to address initially before we even worry about the second or third booster shots. No? So with that, I repeat what I have said earlier. Magpabakuna na po, magpabooster na po tayo sa lalong madaling panahon. Sayang po magkakataon.
Alam mo, Secretary, I'm curious, if you had your way, would you want the third shot, meaning the first booster shot, to be made mandatory? Gugustuhin ko yes. Yun, sir?
Uh-oh. Yes, yes. Ako talaga. I think my fellow IATF principals know my position here. It's very clear. If this could be really made mandatory or quasi-mandatory, it would be for the best interest, no? Of the population protection that we want to sustain so that we continue to have low transmission rate, low mortality rate, low hospital utilization rate. But you see, yun lang ang problema rin natin, Karen, kasi nga mababa lahat. Minsan yung mga tao, iniisip tuloy, siguro okay na kami kasi ilang buwan na since February, March, April, May, June. No? Hindi man sumisipa yung mga kaso despite the super spreader events, no? Yung campaign rallies, yung caravans, yung motorcades, yung mga meeting the avance, even before December, marami na yan eh. But this have not been reflected in any major uptick, no? Minor upticks lang, no? May content, tapos bababa ulit. So, and again, I think I should credit our people for their discipline compliance to our maximum, to our minimum public health standards. So masking.
Okay. Yeah.
So
yeah.
I think, alam mo, we have no current in 2020, we had not even a drop of vaccine to speak of, but we were able to control our surge and our yung mga pinakamataas na kaso natin. For example, ang Delta in July, August last year, hindi tayo lumabas ng more than 22,000.
Yeah. Oo. Tanong ko lang, Secretary. Secretary, do you somehow feel vindicated? I mean, it was very difficult for you in the beginning of the pandemic. You had experts, people from different sectors, lawmakers asking for your resignation, calling the Department of Health's protocols or program a failure. And then suddenly, with as you leave, you have the number of deaths compared to other countries much less. I think it's at less than 2%, if I'm correct, no?
Well,
and then you have the rankings going up to 33, besting other countries. How are you taking all this?
Well, you know, as a public servant, what simply matters to me is that our people are protected. I really don't care what people others say. There will always be critics. You know, you and I know that. You know, in public service, you have critics, people who will assail your earlier policies, your earlier measures. But as the saying goes, right? The proof of the pudding is in the eating. Now, the proof that our policies, 200, by the way, 200 policy issuances, resolutions, no, that serve as a basis for the implementation of our national action plan, 1-4, in fact, and the 5 is something that we're going to give to the next administration as soon as it is completed, with NEDA on top of it, by the way. So what I'm saying is, what we have been doing, and the results can vouch on this, can vouch for me on this. Maganda yung lumalabas na ginagawa natin. And third party, important third party, not self-surveys, not self-serving surveys, but third party, credible third party, doing an evaluation. And now we've massively improved our rankings and besting rich countries, no? Powerful countries, no? America nga, 1,000,000 ng debt. UK, 1,000,000, ano? And tayo, relatively, we're okay. I'm not saying na magaling. What I'm saying is we fare relatively well. Okay, fairly well. So, yes, if what you want me to say is, do I feel vindicated? I always put it in the right context. Kaya naman din kami na-atake, kaya kami na-asin, kasi kulang talaga sa information ng mga tao because the virus continues to evolve. In fact, as we speak today, the Omicron continues to evolve, to mutate. Diba? Dami ng sub-variants or sub-lineages, no? So, people kasi, if they know very little, they tend to talk too much, they tend to be opinionated, they tend to be more specialists than a bona fide specialist, no? The real specialist. No?
But Secretary, Secretary, what could this administration have done better in terms of handling COVID? Like, for example, not one new hospital was built in the 2 years during the pandemic. But go ahead, let's talk about that. Shouldn't there have been more structural improvements that would have helped the healthcare system in the long run?
Oh, yeah, tama ka. But remember, when we were under the pandemic, ang mga tao naka-lockdown. Mga tao, ang mga construction workers, di ba? Took a back seat, di ba? Infrastructure took a back seat. But in spite of that, let me tell you this. We increased our temporary treatment monitoring facilities, no?
Yes.
You can count with the fingers of your hands, no? To about almost 10,000, no? More or less, yeah, no? And to about 110,000 at the maximum bed capacity for our isolation and quarantine. Number two, you look at our laboratory expansion program, no? From one, our IPM, and during that time, we even had to send the specimen to Australia detect if we really had the virus at that time. And now we're almost 330 all over the country, no? And then our hospital bed capacity, from about 2,800 for COVID allocation, we increased it to 30,000, no? And so, ang dami namin pinalawin the capacity. But of course, mahirap, but more challenging because at the same time that we are addressing capacity building, expanding all these measures or interventions, may pandemic, mga tao naka-isolate, naka-quarantine, may iba naka-ICU. So, hindi ito, you know, it's easy to say, you could have done this, you could have done that. You know, that's the problem with us, Karen. We weaponize hindsight. You could do this. No, you know, we are in a state of public health emergency. That should be the backdrop against which all other discussions must proceed. Hindi naman ito normal circumstances. The whole world was brought down to its knees, di ba?
Yeah.
But we are aware. We have, at the same time, expanding, we are implementing as much as we can, and the entire DOH family knows this, the universal health care, di ba?
Yeah. Okay, let's talk about that later in detail, because that would be the legacy, one of the legacies of President Duterte. But looking back, I mean, clearly, with your experience with COVID, you were secretary at such a historical time globally when it comes to health, right? You were health secretary during the time of COVID. What weaknesses did that expose with our health system? Because it did expose weaknesses all over the world. So ano ang nakita nyo na kailangan ng Pilipinas nung nagka-COVID po tayo? You would say more hospitals? Would that be fair?
Yeah, more hospitals, but not really more hospitals, but more capability to expand existing beds for COVID allocation. Kasi it's easy to expand more beds, but if you don't have enough healthcare workers to manage and to run these facilities, that is going to be just a waste of resources, limited or scarce resources. Then number two, ano yung mga na-expose the weaknesses? Marami. Number one, weak epidemiology and surveillance capacity. napalakas na natin yan ngayon. In fact, even the LGU staff have invested much in the surveillance capacity. And then number two would be the procurement and the supply chain. We have adopted together with WHO and some development partners improvement, no? In our stocking of drugs and medicines, of other supplies, and we have expanded capacity of our regional offices and the supply chain logistics. No? And then number three, of course, is a massive adoption of technology. Technology is very, very important. And alam mo, I am very glad to report to you, Karen, and to our people that with this COVID-19, talagang napalawig natin yung One Hospital Command Center and part of the services of the One Hospital Command Center, which navigates, which helps navigate patients through the health system from the temporary treatment monitoring facilities to level 1 hospitals, level 2, level 3, up to the apex hospitals. No? So vertical and horizontal patient navigation system has been put in place. And the technology that, syempre, hindi naman lahat kailangan ma-hospital, lalo na sa Omicron. No? So nagkaroon tayo ng expansion of the patient care pathway to include downstream home isolation. Now, with home isolation, that is not going to be effective unless there is teleconsultation, telemedicine, teleprescription. And we have almost 400,000 teleconsultations that were made during this pandemic, and in particular, during the past surges. No? So a lot of naging mga good practices. No? And I hope the next administration will capitalize on these best practices.
What between us, there were gains. What do you feel were some of the misses? That if you could do it again, what would it be?
Well, some of the misses, I thought, but lately with the Omicron, hindi na rin pala. You know, some people were saying we should have done mass testing, etc. But right now, I think that the IDPF was correct all the while that it stuck with a risk-based targeted testing, because that, according to studies, showed 60% more or less effective in reducing risk of transmission, no? Whereas mass testing only has 2%. And we would have spent 70 to 80 billion pesos if we followed a mass testing policy, meaning testing 5% of the population every week. Yeah. Or in our case, in the Philippines, that's 700,000 tests per day. And at 2,000 pesos, that's 1.4 billion a day. That's about 42 billion a month. Eh kung tatlong buwan yung kagaya ng Delta, that would have been 120 plus billion pesos. Can you imagine? That's almost more than half of the entire DOH budget just for testing.
Yeah. Okay. So overall, you felt it was a miss, but looking back now, it was the right decision to do risk-based. Yes. I'm curious, Secretary, when it comes to health workers, nurses, doctors, there was an issue at one point with salary, COVID bonuses. Do you remember? How would you improve that for the next administration? What do our health workers need?
But the healthcare workers will need certainly a better management of the grant of benefits and compensations. And we have addressed this to a certain degree because the president has already signed the Public Health Emergency Act, I think 11772, but I will double check, no, if that's the correct nomenclature of the law. But yun na nga, i-address pati yung mga hindi na ibigay noong July to December of 2021 in terms of sickness and death benefits, in terms of special risk allowance, or which we have now termed as the one COVID allowance. So at the end of the day, it's a funding issue, Karen. It's a funding problem and a management...
May pera ba yun, sir? May pera ba yun, Secretary?
Magkakaroon ng pera yan kasi ang sinabi naman ng Pangulo, talagang kahanapan yan ng pondo. Ang importante may bakas. So that the president can now realign or has the authority to use and utilize funds from 2021 and also for 2022 and reallocate them to address the gaps in the compensation and allowances, benefits for sickness and death benefits to good. So ina-address na po lahat ito. Pero yung management, ano ang problema natin? Ito pala isa sa mga learning points. Pagka devolve ang health service, so national and local, because of local government code, ang sirap pala patakbuhin. You don't have a unified plan. Kasi ang government yun is, yung mga boss doon, ang mga governors, mga mayors, ang reaction time matagal. Hindi yung gaya kung monolithic yung organization, parang military, from top hanggang sa barangay healthcare workers. Hawak mo, you have a unified command, the response, it turnaround is much, much quicker. Now, it's so difficult because ang daming barriers, to the administration of measures for pandemic response. So this is something that I want the next administration to ponder on. Is it time to reintegrate the health system? Remember, education is not devolved. Pero devolved nila in 1992, which I think to me was, I never supported that, by the way. I don't believe that the health should have been devolved.
I still see.
Health has to be integrated. There's a unified command. Okay. In pandemic, you cannot afford to waste time. You have to get all your orders down and implemented and executed as clearly and as responsibly as best you can.
Well, that's quite surprising. So what you're saying is, with devolution, instead of making pandemic services and action faster, it made it slower.
Initially, yes. No, and then also remember, because of the devolution, iba-iba yung priority ng mga local chief executives. No? Others, I hate to say this, but I must tell you, they did not prioritize health programs. And so sila yung talagang laggard on the things quick turnaround response. No? So yan ang mga maraming mga learning points dito that I would like to discuss with the next administration and the next Secretary of Health. So that we can learn from the good or the best practices and also the bad ones. No? That how we can avoid them and how do we address them so that they will not happen again. What I can say is the IATF stood very cohesive, very solid, and always outward its policy issuances on data, on evidence-based science and medicine. And we don't have a dearth of experts. Maraming po tayong magagaling ng mga experts, no? Na talaga naman nag-ambag ng magagandang inputs, no? Kanilang expertise, kanilang paalaman, ay talagang ibinuhos nila. And I'm so proud of all of our health experts who contributed to our success.
All right. Now, Secretary, very quickly, let's talk about the legacy and also, maybe a wish list that you never had, but the legacy. You would consider the universal health care law as the legacy of this administration when it comes to health.
Absolutely. It's the universal healthcare. And tama ka kanina yung statement mo. The COVID pandemic actually unraveled a lot of gaps or weaknesses in our health system, both national and local. But the COVID also served as a catalyst for accelerating the implementation of vital provisions of universal healthcare law, as I've told you. The surveillance and epidemiological system strengthening, the procurement supply chain, the adoption of telemedicine, teleconsultations to complement home isolation benefit packages, even telehealth has already put together the COVID home isolation benefit package, no? And that will be reimbursed, no? Whoever provides the service will be reimbursed. And then we have massive social marketing campaigns, no? We have promotion started. We have the PIDA solution, which gave DOH the unveil, the prestigious unveil awards, the Quill awards, marami awards kami natanggap because of social marketing campaigns.
But clearly, what you're saying is it's the universal healthcare law that this administration will be remembered for in terms of its health legacy.
That is correct. But remember, it's a 10-year implementation of the law. Mm-hmm. So it is a progressive realization of universal healthcare. But we have already started integrating about 40 plus of 60 province and city-wide integration of health systems, meaning networking na, no? Para mas magabayan, mas madali ang mga pasyente, ano ba ang appropriate health facility na dapat puntahan? Kasi naging problema din natin, Karen, sa COVID, lahat hospital lang puntahan. Kahit na walang sakit, kahit na nag-positive lang, puntahan
Secretary. Sa hospital. Okay. Now, very quickly, is there anything that you would have done differently? I mean, you are leaving office and this might be your last government post, right? Yes. Would that be fair to say? Because also, you said in one interview, you're tired, correct? But you are leaving with a Senate Blue Ribbon Committee report recommending the filing of graft and plunder charges against you, questioning the transfer of funds from the DOH to the PSDBM. Would you have done that differently, Secretary?
No, I would have not done that differently because I will have to, this is a whole of government approach. And as I told you in our earlier interviews, I trusted the institution. I did not trust personalities. And PSDBM is an attached agency of BBM. BBM is the one that leads in the formulation of the National Expenditure Plan for the entire bureaucracy. And that PSDBM is part of BBM. And if I did not do what I did, we would have lost more lives. More health doctors and nurses would have lost lives. Can you imagine that? And I'm sure if that would have happened, they're going to call me again and they will say, you are guilty. We say you're guilty of criminal negligence, hinayaan mo mamatay yung mga doktor, at mga nurses, mga medtech. No. Hindi namin kaya. 41.4 billion pesos, such a huge amount. We never procured at that level, Karen. Ang pinakamataas namin procurement was siguro 5 to about 10 billion vaccines at that. No? And the vaccines that was through UNICEF. So, hindi namin kakayanin. And what would have been the untold consequences? Many more doctors would have died. Remember, March, ang dami naman matay ng mga doktor.
So no regrets there. Yeah.
No regrets.
None. You are standing by that decision.
Yes.
Okay.
There's no evidence of wrongdoing, Karen. You know, we gave them all the documents. Unfortunately, they did not include documents that countered their initial findings. I'll give you an example. Sabi nila, overpricing. Okay, COA never said anything in its report that there was overpricing. Then next, I'll tell you. Ano overpricing? DOH in 2015, hindi ako secretary dyan, ha? 2015-2016, PPEs, ang kanilang presyo when they bought was 3,500. Okay, more expensive. Okay. Yeah. Sa amin, ang nilagay namin na suggested retail price was 2,000. And more components. Sila was 8 or 9 kami, 9 to 10 components. So these PPEs was more complete, okay? Were more complete than those purchased earlier. And at 2,000 compared to 3,500. Okay. Lumabas ba yung investigation? No, hindi yan lumabas sa report. Ang dami namin like mounds of documents.
Do you feel the Senate was unfair, just quickly? The Senate was unfair?
To me, yes. Yes, okay. To me and to all those who have been implicated but only had in their heart to save lives, to protect lives of our healthcare workers, of our doctors and nurses and medtechs and rad techs, everyone. Okay. They were dying, you know.
All right. My last question already is, do you have recommendations for the next health secretary? Were you asked for leave?
Plenty, Karen. I have I will have a lot of recommendations. First and foremost, we will hand over a playbook, one, a playbook that will consist of course, a compendium of 200, both published and unpublished COVID-19 response resolutions, policy issuances, and the guidelines and protocols that we have put together to execute, prevent, detect, isolate, treat, reintegrate, vaccination plus booster strategy. And all the things that have been assailed initially, I will explain to the next administration why, even if initially our policies were assailed, how we can see that the results are vindicating us, that the results show that to begin with, those policies were right, okay, carefully formulated, with the benefit, not self-serving, but with the benefit of third-party groups of experts, individuals, and an effective whole of government and whole of society. You know, the private sector role in this is something that cannot afford to miss. No? I'm so thankful to the private sector as well.
All right. In one word, Secretary, how would you describe your stint at the DOH?
Most difficult, considering this is my second. You know, the first time I was Secretary of Health, I led the country in the AH1N1 pandemic. Alam mo yon? Alam mo yon, Karen, when you tell me about AH1N1. So this is more difficult by a factor of 10. So this is the most difficult secretaryship that I ever held. This is the most difficult position that I ever held, but no regrets. I did my best. I gave all whatever God gave me as a human being, as a person. I can always say I tried my best and I did my best. So hindi po sapat, pasensya na lang po. Bigyan na natin sa mga susunod na marami pang magagaling din dyan na mga secretaries na pwede maging secretaries of health. No? So let's leave it at that. And I thank President Duterte for the opportunity to appoint me first as chairman of the government service system and then now as a second time Secretary of Health.
On that note, Secretary Francisco Duque, thank you for joining me today, sir, and good luck to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much to you too, Karen, for the opportunity on behalf of the DOH and the IATF. Maraming salamat.